Now, what happens is a lot of times you capture the requirements, you understand the requirement rather, right? So the customer tells you something and then you understand the requirement, okay? Now the customer might be expecting something, right? So you must be expecting something like this and you understood it like this, let's say, right? Now the customer says, you know, there should be a way to, for the person to sit. You just think, okay, you know, there is a place to sit, and then it should, the customer says, you know, should be able to swing, even this would swing. So you think that the customer would, you know, the requirement was met, right? And you should, you think that, you know, this would be okay with the customer. The customer would think that, you know, you would give me the product exactly which looks like this, because this is what you are looking at, right? Now there is a disconnect. If you see, the customer wants something, you are delivering something else, right? Now when does this come up? Usually it comes up during testing, right? So you will take the requirement, you would design and develop it, and then you will take it to the customer and then say, you know what, I have developed the product, now you test it. The customer would say, you know what, this is not what I was expecting. So when is this identified? This is identified during the testing phase. Not a good thing to do. Why? Because you're wasted a lot of time in designing, and you've wasted a lot of time in your design and development, and now the customer says that he doesn't like it. What should you do? Right? So it's a waste of time, right? So there is a disconnect. We should have plugged that disconnect right at the requirements phase rather than at the testing time, right? So it makes sense to, you know, fix those disconnects in your both your understandings right at the start. Now how can we plug those disconnects? We can do that by prototyping, right? So we can exactly create those wireframes or mock-up screens, which would basically say that, you know, this is how your screen would look like, right? And this is exactly what you can expect as your final product, right? So that's called as prototyping. Now the advantage of this is, you know, both of you would understand it either this way or this way. So, you know, the customer is clear that, you know, I'm going to get, let's say, you know, you're going to get this. So the customer knows that he's going to get this. You also know that you have to deliver this. The technical team also knows that you have to deliver this, right? So how do we get to that stage? By creating prototypes, right? Now prototype is nothing but a screen or a view of the screen, which basically tells how your final product would look like. So maybe something like this, right? So it could be as simple as that. You're drawing a screen sketch and then explaining that your screen would look like this, right? So this is the most primitive type of prototype, right? And it can be done very easily. You can just draw it and then say, you know, explain how it looks like. And more or less, when you deliver your final product, you know, the customer should be happy, because, you know, he knows that, you know, broadly this is the layout of the screen, this is where the video occurs, this is where the suggestions would come in, this is where the social media integration comes in, and this is where the comments comes in, right? So, you know, more or less you would be aligned to this, both of them are aligned to the final way in which the screen should look like, okay? So prototypes bring in that clarity, right? So both you guys would understand it in the same way, okay? So that's the advantage of the prototype, okay? So wherever possible, you should create those prototypes, right? So the typical process would be, you'd first understand the requirements, you would have those one-on-one discussions, and, you know, use observation technique wherever possible to get more details about it, and then you would validate that understanding by drawing prototypes, okay? So a close to, you know, 70-80% of your project, you generally requirements you would capture using these techniques, very common techniques, Now I'll give you a little more details about the prototyping. I hope the overall process in which we should approach is clear to you guys. Any questions? Let's take a quick checkpoint here before I move ahead with the prototyping. Just wanted to make sure that you are clear with this, the way you should approach your requirements. What kind of questions to ask? How do you get those first level of knowledge? How do you enhance it by asking what kind of questions? How to leverage an observation technique? Is this clear? Anything which
how
you want me
to create a mockup like a
right. So see, the most easier one is use a pen and paper and then sketch it. It could be as simple as that. Now there are some softwares where we can actually create mockup screens. Then you could actually create the screen. So something like if you have a HTML developer, right? You could actually use that person to develop the screen, right? So this is the nearest you could get to a prototype and the final version, right? So if you actually create this as a prototype, right? So there won't be any disconnect between you and the customer. It's as good as your final product, right? Except that it won't have the underlying functionality. Only the screen view is what is created as part of this prototype, right? So it could vary from a basic sketch which you're drawing using a pen and paper. It could come in somewhere in between by wherein you would use some software to create the wireframes. It could be your near final version wherein you would use a developer to develop your screens, right? So that differs. It differs from context to context, project to project. Depends on the level of clarity you want. So that's primarily a business analyst decision. So I wouldn't say you always have to create this prototype for all the projects. Neither I would say you just stick to the basic prototypes. So you will have to evaluate that situation, and wherever you feel I need that exact clarity on how the screen should look like, you go for this kind of version. If a broad indication is good enough, you'll go for this kind of prototypes. So it depends. So there is no one single answer for that kind of question. Okay. So again, drawing this prototype is not a big deal, right? So the easiest, simplest one is this. Then you have so many you have so many tutorials available, right? So the basic one is what you sketch, right? So then you have some softwares like this ML Webco is one software, right? There are so many softwares like that. Like Lynda is another one, right? HTML Toronto is another one, right? So there are multiple types of prototyping software, right? And you don't need to be an expert in all of that, right? So there are some people who are experts in usability, since their responsibility to draw the wireframes, right? So you broadly get that indication, and then you would engage this usability guy to create those screens. Worst case scenario, you'll have to learn the software, and I would say it would take you maybe an hour or 2 hours to understand that one. So not a big deal. Just that we need to be aware of that there are some wireframe softwares which you can use, and since they are so widely or so different type of wireframe softwares available, there is no point covering all of them in this course, right? So you can learn it on your own. It's not so complicated thing. But what I would spend on is the various types of prototyping and how would you engage your SME to go through this prototyping session. So broadly, there are some classifications of prototyping and all, which I would cover. Are you clear with this? The overall way in which we would have approached our requirements. Now, do you get a sense of how to approach a requirement, right? So it should not, at least if I'm asked to capture the requirement about a customer registration, right? So what's the first thing that I would do? And then, I'll go and ask for some documents. Show me your current customer registration form. I'll try to understand those process. Then I'll go prepared with the list of questions that I should go with, and then ask questions for that. So broadly, you know, you have that framework of primary flow, alternate flows, prerequisites, notifications, and then, you know, your exception flows. All those would you know, kind of details you would capture by asking those questions. You know, you'll figure out all of that. And then maybe there is a current manual process in which they're capturing the, doing the customer registration. You could figure that out by going for an observation technique, right? So broadly, you know, you get a sense of how to understand the requirement, right? Now, once you understood the requirement, you have to ensure that you and the customer are clear about how the final system would look like. There should not be any disconnect. To reduce those disconnects, we'll use prototype. So, yeah, prototyping and the rest of the techniques we'll take in the following sessions. But yeah, any questions regarding to the near topics that we covered today, or you know, as part of the requirements panel?
So Raju, I would like to let us just have a brief summary of today's class.
Okay. So quickly, I think that's a good way to end the session. Now, once you have done with the planning, right, so you'd have a detailed project plan coming out. And, you know, you have the work breakdown structure also. On this particular day, I'm going to capture this requirement, right? So, you know, how would you approach capturing the detailed requirements for that? Now, for most of the requirements, you'll follow these three steps, right? So this three-step process, where first step, you would read some documents and then gain that first level of knowledge, right? So I would suggest, you know, you should ask for these documents right the moment you know what project you are getting into, right? So don't wait till all your project planning is completed and everything is completed. And then say, no, first 3 days, right? The moment you are onboarded onto your project, daily spend some time to understand what the requirement is about, right? So there are multiple sources of information, right? So you could even search on internet, you could ask for some process documents within the organization, you could look at your competitor products, you could look at regulatory websites, you could look at the existing way the systems are, the current systems are working, you could look at some customer suggestion log, excuse me. You could figure out all those documents and read through them. So it would vary from project to project, depending on the project type, the kind of documentation available will also be different. So you need to figure out what documents are relevant and then read that documents to get that first level of understanding, right? Then, you know, each requirement, when you go for your requirement illustration, as per that work breakdown structure, what you prepared, you know, you go prepared with a list of questions, right? So what kind of questions to ask? I introduce you to a broad framework. You focus on the process flow, then, you know, what are all the alternate flows, check out for those prerequisites, check out for those notifications, and then check out for those exception conditions where something fails, right? So broadly, this will cover you the most kind of question that you want to cover, right? Also, any non-functional requirements, like, you know, is there any you know, performance requirements or security requirements, right? So these are all your non-functional requirements. You should ask about those non-functional requirements as well, right? So more about what kind of non-functional requirements would come in, I'll explain you about that, you know, later when we look at the requirements documentation. Okay, so broadly that is what we looked at. Now once we understand the requirement, the next step what we generally do is we would make sure that the customer also understands it in the same way. Right? So how do we do that? We do that using prototyping. Right? So basically we are creating some screens and then you know, we are saying that here you know, this is how your final screens would look like, and the customer also can clearly understand that, you know what, your final screens would look like this. So both of them agree onto this you know, in the, agree to this way. Okay. I hope that gives you that a summary view of what you have to do for most of the requirements. Now, there are some techniques like focus groups and then reverse engineering workshops and all. They are relevant only under specific context and specific scenarios, circumstances. So we will understand where they would be relevant and all in the following sessions. But for most of your requirements, this is what you would follow. You would read some documents to get the first level of understanding. You would interview the SMEs, ask those questions and get the responses. And then, wherever possible, you would get into a demonstration and then understand the requirements. And finally, you would validate your understanding by prototyping, creating the prototypes or the wireframes and all. Okay?
Okay.
Right. So again, the next 1-2 sessions all would be a little more theoretical, it's very qualitative, I would say, right? So unless you, it's more like you are trying to understand the process. So there is no definite guidance or some definite framework which would come in. They are more soft skills, I would say, which will help you understand the requirements better.